I was telling someone the other day, I love songs that give the entirety of the gospel, and because that's something that we can rehearse over and over again, and I love to be able to do that because it reminds us. And I don't know about you, but we need to be reminded. I do. I forget sometimes what I'm going into the next room for. I'll leave in the back, and I think, okay, I've got to go in the kitchen, and I'll get in there, and I think, what am I doing in here? What was I coming to get? And then I have to trace my steps back, and that's not just old age, folks. I'm not that old, but I think it's maybe the busyness of our minds that we shove too much information in there, and we don't focus on the right thing at the right time. Well, sometimes at Easter time, the season, you know, we, especially in Augusta, you know, we have a joke around here that when Master Sunday is Easter Sunday, Easter's a bust. Isn't that sad? But it's sort of that way. We can't do what other places do when it's that time because our city sort of shuts down, things happen. But nevertheless, we're going to remember. We're going to look back, and we're going to take a survey of events that we know most likely very, very well. Those events are going to be the story of our Savior. So we're going to do sort of a little, in some ways topical, I don't usually do that, but a topical series called Savior. And that Savior has a beautiful story of hope. Hope, betrayal, tragedy, and triumph. And so we're going to be looking these next 4 weeks, and I hope you can be here for most of them, if not all of them. It's a great time for the church to remember that God's promise to send the Messiah who would overcome sin, who would overcome death forever, he kept that promise perfectly in Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. And he promises to return again for his people. That's stuff that we know, isn't it? We could write that down. You could write that sentence out without even having to look it up. But to go back and to be reminded of these things, of why our faith is as it is, this is a great time of year to be able to do that. So we're going to, in these next weeks, we're going to follow the footsteps of Jesus during that last week of his life upon this earth by remembering his very first advent, which we celebrated not too many months ago. We're going to be able to experience why he came and look forward to his second advent, and that is expectantly waiting for the fulfillment of the hope that he gives. So today we have entitled our message in this series, number one, The Beautiful Story of Hope. Now you'll see there in that graphic, there's something that you look at, you think, what is that? That is palm branches. So today is in effect like Palm Sunday. We're going to walk with Jesus as he enters into Jerusalem. Now, in his day and in our day, the world that we live in is hopelessly broken, most definitely. And that word hope, the beautiful story of hope, has a whole lot of understandings and misunderstandings that we have. Sometimes we name one of our children Hope. We talk about having hope. It can become a political slogan. It can become something that we hold on to in trying times. But hope in the Greek is this. It means this according to the Greek language. To anticipate, to welcome. It is the expectation of what is sure and certain. Okay? So that doesn't mean I hope I'll lose weight after I eat this pint of ice cream. That's not an expectation of what's going to happen or what is sure as certain. But I can say I have the hope of heaven because that is certain and it is sure to happen. I have not experienced that yet, but I expect to have that hope. So this Easter story that we put this hope into is a beautiful story of our Savior, and it dawns into a dark, broken world, but it illuminates the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And one day, we will fully realize the hope in which we live in right now. So we could say that this story reveals a possibility of turning away from despair and turning towards hope. That's what Jesus came for, and that's why as he enters in here into Jerusalem, it is a story that is full of hope. Now, the very first time that hope is mentioned in the Bible is, and we just read it not long ago as we read through the scripture this year, is by Naomi in the book of Ruth, and she's responding to her daughter-in-laws that there was not any hope, there was no hope of her having any more sons. Now, she was older, most definitely, and she'd lost her husband, she'd lost her two sons, and all she had was two foreign-born, two Gentile daughter-in-laws, and they were living in a foreign land at that. That's no hope. She said her line would not go on. Of course, we know the story that that Ruth stayed with her mother-in-law, went back to their homeland and marries Boaz, and that is actually in the lineage of Jesus right there. So there was hope, even though she didn't understand that there was hope. It reminds us that God himself wants us and desires that we trust him and that we know his hope, even when our life's circumstances look as if there might not be any hope. A diagnosis, a situation, an I don't love you anymore, I hate you, or you're fired. Those are situations sometimes that we look at and we think there's no hope. God wants us to trust him in those situations to see that there is hope, and it is a beautiful story even in difficult times. So hope is not wishful thinking, but hope is trusting God himself and what he has promised in his word. It's sad, though, most of the world that we live in will not trust. Sometimes it's hard for those of us who profess faith in Christ to trust him and to trust him completely. We will not trust in the promise of this hope. We will not see the beautiful side, the beautiful story of hope that God wants to offer to us, because in some ways it doesn't make sense. It doesn't fit into what we want to happen or what we think should happen in this world. So this upside-down aspect of hope is what we're going to look at today, because that's the key, I believe, from the passage that we're going to see. Now, every week we're going to look at an event. So around this entry, around Palm Sunday-ish, the hope of Palm Sunday, the betrayal of Maundy Thursday, when Jesus is there taking the Passover meal with his disciples, and what happens there in the garden as he goes to pray. The tragedy of Good Friday as he's crucified there on that hill. And it culminates with the triumph of Easter Sunday morning with the resurrection. Well, in our text today, Luke chapter 19 has a little longer introduction for the whole series, but Luke chapter 19, let's go ahead and turn in our Bibles there to 28 through 44. You're probably already there saying, I wish he would shut up and get on with it. So we're going to read the scripture in just a moment. But our 3 points today, the first point that we're going to look at is hope enters. Hope enters. You're like, well, that's an awkwardly worded thing, isn't it? Hope has to arrive. For hope to be present, it has to arrive. And Jesus, the hope of the world, arrives on the scene in Luke chapter 19, verses 28 through 44. Let's read it together. And this is such a good passage, and it's good to read it at this time of year. When he had said this, now he had been talking there in those preceding verses. Lazarus had been raised. There's a whole bunch of things that had happened. Zacchaeus in chapter 19 there, and he was talking about, goodness, where's my, I've lost my little page here. Everyone who has will be given from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. Bring here those enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them and slay them before me. He's talking about the master and the minas and all of that. So this is kind of a referral back to that when he says, when he had said this. So in light of all of that, he went on ahead going up to Jerusalem. And it came to pass when he drew near to Bethpage and Bethany, and that's just on the cusp of Jerusalem. We think that that's far. Israel's only about the size of New Jersey. It's very small. So Bethany is really close. It would be kind of like Martinez and Evans. It's really, really close to one another. He drew near to Bethpage and Bethany at the mountain called Olivet. that he sent two of his disciples saying, go into the village opposite you, where as you enter, you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, why are you loosing it? Thus you shall say to him, because the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent went their way and found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, why are you loosing the colt? And they said, the Lord has need of him. All right, so it happened just as the Lord had told them that it was going to happen. Now, I want you to know that the church traditionally celebrates the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. I mean, we've done that my whole life. That's what Palm Sunday is about. We get out our branches and, you know, or we sing about that. We sing about Hosanna, all of those things that we look at for Palm Sunday traditionally. However, and this is pretty convincing as I studied, many put forth that that actually did not happen on Sunday, but it happened on Monday. And this is why. And this is why I would tend to believe this. Ladies, if you're studying the gospel on the ground, your Bible study, you're going to see that there are things that happen on the calendar of the world that are symbolic in Christ's ministry and what he came to do. And that's sort of where we are right here with this. The law of Moses in Exodus chapter 12 required, we just read it not long ago, that the Passover lamb was to be selected on what day? The 10th day. The 10th day of the first month. That is the month of Nisan. And then it was to be sacrificed on the 14th day. And that was specified there in the law of Moses. The year that we believe that Jesus was crucified, that 10th day fell on a Monday during Passover week. So as we look at Jesus coming in, it doesn't say here that we have traditionally looked at it as Sunday, but as their calendar and as their days sort of run together, it helps to make sense of some things that I don't have time to go into, but I've never really understood that to be on a Monday, but this convinced me in a great way. I encourage you to look at that because it's something that is very influential if you're looking at all of the rest of things in Scripture that have yet to be fulfilled. I believe that they will happen on those days that are significant in the calendar that God has given. For instance, like the Feast of First Fruits and the fall feasts that are to come. I believe that these are things that really help us to understand, not to know the day or the hour, but to know the season of what is on the calendar for us in the future. I like what John MacArthur said. He said, when he entered Jerusalem that day, Jesus was fulfilling the role as the Father's chosen lamb in much the same way that the Jewish people chose their Passover lambs there for the temple. Completing the parallel, Christ was killed on Friday, the 14th of Nisan, with all the thousands of other lambs, but he was the one true sacrifice for sin. Now that's absolutely amazing, folks, and it shows us the truth of God's word of how it all brings down that God is not a random God, just didn't say, well, there's no other thing to do, I might as well do this. That's not it. From the beginning of time, God had planned and had given these clues all around that we would know that Jesus was Messiah and that God was rescuing us in him. It's like John chapter 1 verse 29 says, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So the Jews should have expected Jesus, and some did, but very, very few. And even more so should we expect him on this very day when he was coming into Jerusalem there at the Passover feast. The Lamb was now approaching, and hope was entering into the city. I love to read fiction that is good and based upon historical things. And one of my favorite writers is Bodie Taney, and one of the biblical narrative books series I read, she says this, everything means something. In God's word, everything means something. It's there for a purpose. And as we study and as we understand it, it can open up to us a deeper understanding that allows us to know the veracity of God's word that we can trust more and more. You say, well, what good is that? I'll tell you what good it is. When your life goes crashing down and everything is gone, and you look up and you have nowhere else to go. To know the truth of God's word is there gives us hope, and that's what Jesus came to do, to give us hope. So to look forward, to see this right there, is expectant looking. Expectant looking is the antidote for apathetic living. That's where it hits us right now. So the habitual practice of looking forward, looking at Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, is to produce a life in us that is lived with a focus for the future. That's what Jesus was doing as he was looking forward to his focus. That's what all of the Old Testament saints hoped for, and that's what the church hopes for as we wait for Christ to return the second time. Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 14 says this: "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works." That's it. We need to memorize that passage. Matter of fact, you watch. It's going to be on the list this year because it's so strong. One of my favorite speakers, Stephen Cole, says, "Christ's first appearance was in grace, bringing salvation. During his first coming, his glory was mostly veiled," and we see that right here. "But his second appearing will be in glory, bringing salvation to his people, but terrifying judgment to those who have not believed in him. His second coming is a blessed hope for those who know him, because then we will fully experience all of the blessings of his salvation." Now, I'm kind of stealing my thunder as I go forward this next point, but that was such a great quote, I wanted to include it right there because that's what's happening. So looking expectantly for Jesus is the remedy that we have to counteract the effects of the poison which we live in right now, the darkness, the ungodliness, the worldly lust that attack us and that many times we fall into day after day, and the motivation to live in this present age. As we have tasted the gospel of Jesus Christ, we are to live with a view to Christ entering into our lives and showing us and leading us to that hope. Arthur Pink says, "To be truly looking for that blessed hope is a spiritual attitude. It's the longing of those whose hearts are right with God." I pray that hope enters into us and does more than just plop, that it actually leads us, because hope has to enter in. So hope is blessed. Hope is spiritual because it changes us. It causes us to see the real inner reality of what's going on in our lives. Not just the surface of the situation and the circumstance, but what the goal is. And the goal is that we may be like Jesus, that we may look like him, that we might be his disciple. What's going on in our lives, what's going on in the world, God knows, he sees, he has great purpose for allowing all of it. Now, I want you to note before we move on here, there's something in this part of Scripture that I think is important, and that is the donkey colt. All right, now I've not been around donkeys a whole lot in my life. I've been around horses, but not donkeys, and I know that donkeys are kind of a strange little thing. They're smaller, and they got bigger teeth, and you know, we make all kinds of jokes and everything about them. But Jesus sent two of his disciples to Bethpage and Bethany, that little area right there. And when he did this, he showed his command of all of nature. He showed his omniscience. He showed his knowledge by telling them what they were going to find. They were going to find an unbroken colt. Now, what is that? That's a colt that's not been trained. He's never been ridden. No one's ever been seated on him. Because if there's anything you know about a donkey, what does a donkey do besides bite? He kicks. And what does he do when someone sits on him? He has to be trained so that he won't bite and so that he won't kick. So that's what a donkey is supposed to be. The donkey is a royal animal in Scripture. And because this was an entry, because hope enters, it was the coronation presentation of the King of Kings. That's really what it was. Well, wait a minute. Why wasn't he like riding a white horse, waving a flag and saying, "Charge!" like what the world would do? Well, because that's not who Jesus was. In the past, David had arranged, King David had arranged for Solomon to ride a donkey, his donkey, into Jerusalem so that he would be anointed as the king of Israel there while David was preparing to die. That's from 1 Kings, I've got it listed here as chapter 1, but I don't believe it. 132, yes, it is. Okay, so I was correct. I was thinking it was a little bit later. But that's what he did. He rode that donkey in. This is exactly referring to that right there, that Jesus was rightfully on the seat of David to be able to ride into Jerusalem. So this event was very important. It was a symbol, and it's something interesting. The only time that Jesus allowed such a grand thing in his honor to be conducted. Before, he would not. He would not allow that. And he would sneak away and he would to make sure that that did not happen. But on this day, at this specific time in the world, in place in history, this is what Jesus allowed because he was fulfilling the prophecy of Zechariah from 500 years before in chapter 9, and you might know this if you've sung Messiah before, Handel's great work, you know this, you've sung this. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. That was written by Zechariah 500 years before Christ. There was no white horse of a conquering charismatic leader to save them from Rome. And by the way, that would have been temporary at best, wouldn't it? Because kingdoms rise and fall. No, Jesus Christ, the Savior, the Messiah, God's Son, the spotless Lamb, entered on a lowly donkey, conquering sin to save them from themselves, and that is a permanent thing that lasts throughout all eternity. So hope entered not in the grandiosity of man, but in the humility of Yeshua the Messiah. Our second point today, hope celebrates. Hope celebrates. So hope has to enter, and then hope celebrates, but it's a little different than what we would think. Verse 35 through 40, it says this, then they brought him to Jesus, and they threw their, this is where he's talking about the donkey, and they threw their own clothes on the colt, and they set Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. Then as he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, teacher, rebuke your disciples. But he answered and said to them, I tell you, that's always important when you see that written by Jesus, spoken by Jesus. I tell you that if these should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out. So the crowd is now throwing down their cloaks in an act of submission to him. This is as if they were like placing themselves under his feet. So they were saying, we want to be led by you. It was a willing act of submission that they were giving unto him because they expected him to be their ruler, to be their king, if you would. That's all the symbolism that is there, and Jesus is willingly taking it, although it does not mean what they think it does. It means something totally different to him. So this crowd of disciples, it says in the scripture, were gathering so that they would be able to see. They wanted to go everywhere he had been. Why? Because they saw what he was doing. Now, don't forget that this is right after Lazarus was raised from the dead on the third day. Now, that's a pretty big deal, okay? If you hear of somebody who's dead, and they're dead 3 days, and they're over there at Platt's, and they're all laid out, and I walk over there, and I say, get up! And they raise up out of that casket, and they get up, and they go home and take a shower and eat. Do you think that's going to make the news? It's going to make the news, okay? It is, and you're going to want to watch every single thing about it. You're going to want to hear about it. You're going to want to know about it. There it is. They knew Lazarus was dead. He'd been dead 3 days. Yea, he stinketh. Okay? He'd been dead for 3 days. They saw him. They had witnessed it with their own eyes. There wasn't a lot of stress. It was incredible, but they had to believe it because it was there in front of them. It was real. It was tangible. So they wanted to be there at all times. They wanted to say, oh, we're going to follow you. There's been no one like you. So Psalm 118:26 was their cry. By the way, they memorized Scripture. Just remember that, okay? But they didn't even begin to grasp, though, as they cried out with that, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. They didn't begin to grasp how deep what they were doing really went. I found this quote by a commentator named Trent Butler. He says this, finally, Jesus' glory was openly recognized. He was more than the babe of Nazareth or a Galilean rabbi. He was more than just a miracle worker. He was a royal figure entering the royal city down the royal road. He showed that the hopes of Israel were being fulfilled. God had sent the messianic king to bring peace, a peace that only heaven can establish, and a peace established in heaven that cannot be negated upon the earth. This means that the angels who rejoice over one sinner who represents or who repents now see all the heavenly glory of God's plan of salvation being brought to fruition. As earthlings praise the king on the donkey, so heaven glories in God's work of salvation. So hope celebrates on earth, here, in one way, and in heaven, and really and truly for the same reason, but two completely different sides of that reason. So they were crying out for deliverance from Rome, as we see, and Jesus was giving them deliverance from sin. The real celebration was not for a coming political revolution, but for the greatest revolution that the earth had ever known, the beautiful story of hope that was coming to them, and it was a celebration. But not everyone was pleased. We read right here in that we saw the Pharisees were there in full force. They were watching as they had been, standing off, not participating, but watching to see what was going on. And they were limiting the celebration. You know, if you have someone who stands on the edge, a guard or someone that's there, they're going to put a damper on what's happening because they're there to stop it from going too far. That's what the Pharisees were actually doing right over there, looking over the shoulders, and they were crying out. And they were hollering, and they were saying, ah. And you see what they said right there when they hollered out. They said, teacher, rebuke your disciples. Why? Because they could tell what was happening. And it was the first time that Jesus had allowed this lavish show of them really giving him the crown of their king. That was what was happening, and they didn't want the problems with Rome, and they didn't want the problems with him, and they had already plotted to not only kill Lazarus, but to kill Jesus also. So Jesus says to them, they went, and he went, there's a lot of stuff going on like that. He said, there's no way. There's no way that this can be stopped. Why was there no way that it could be stopped? Because it was God's plan from the beginning. It had been set into motion before man had ever even been created. It was in the heart of God to rescue his people. And Jesus was always the way, and Jesus was there. There was no way that he could or would stop what was happening. So this part right there, when he says that, was a dramatic turning point of the entire event. Never seen this before. It was a revolutionary to me. The Pharisees that represented all of Judaism, his chosen people, the people who God chose to put Messiah in so that he would come, they were foreshadowing exactly what was going to happen. John MacArthur says, the scene here moves from joy to horror. The crowd speaks of peace. Now he's going to speak of destruction. They pronounce on him glory, and he pronounces on them doom. He was telling them, these Pharisees, and us as we read this, if these ones, the ones who are cheering right now, if these ones become silent from celebration, which they will do just 1 week later at the cry for his death, crucify him, people are so fickle, aren't they? He says, then the very stones will scream. And that word, kretzo, means scream. It means that they're going to cry out, not in praise unto the Lord, but in affirmation of God's judgment on Israel's wickedness and the refusal of Messiah. Now that's something I've never understood in that underside, that dark side up underneath. I thought he was saying, when we don't praise him, then will the very rocks cry out. That's not exactly what he's saying here. He's saying these rocks are going to cry out when it's silent. And he's foreshadowing, and this next section is going to show us. Now, in my Bible, I have notes that are written all over from years and years. I have no idea who this belongs to, but it's worth repeating, and it's so good. And it talks about where Jesus looked. Right here at this spot, Jesus looked back and he saw how Israel had wasted opportunities and been ignorant of its time of visitation while he was among them. He looked within all of them and he saw spiritual ignorance and blindness in their hearts. And this is the people who are going, woo, waving palm branches. He looked around and he saw religious activity in these Pharisees that accomplished very little and caused a hindrance to them. He looked ahead, though, and he saw the judgment that was coming to the nation of Israel, coming to the city of Jerusalem, and coming to the temple. So hope not only entered into Jerusalem, hope not only celebrates on earth and heaven for different reasons, but lastly, hope weeps. Hope weeps. Verse 41 says this, now as he drew near, he saw the city and wept over it. Now remember, this is a day that we think, woo, celebration, celebrate, good times, come on. We think of that on Palm Sunday, don't we? This is the same moment. This is what Jesus did. He said, if you had known, even you, especially in this your day, the things that make for your peace. But now they are hidden from your eyes, for days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment around you, surround you and close you in on every side and level you and your children within you to the ground, and they will not leave in you one stone upon another because you did not know the time of your visitation. That's the heart of Christ that was right there. Tina, there's a picture that I sent you. There's a place in Jerusalem that we visit when we go on a Holy Land tour, and it's called the Chapel of the Dominus Flevit. Okay? Dominus Flevit is directly across from the Temple Mount, and it's one of my favorite places to go. And it is a little tiny little thing. And up at the top of it, I didn't include this picture, there is a mosaic of a hen. With the chicks, okay? Because that's really this passage. So that chapel was built at the traditional spot where it is believed, according to this, it may not be the spot on, you know, GPS, but it's roughly there that as Jesus was looking out, he was at that spot, that hillside that looks over into Temple Mount, which the Dome of the Rock right there is sitting right about where the temple would have sat in Jerusalem in the background. He would have looked out that spot and said this very thing, how I weep over you, I long to gather you, scripture really says in another passage, like a hen gathers her chicks. He came to protect, to give hope, to give peace. And this is what happened. You're able to see all of the Temple Mount, and look at how they positioned it that you can see through it. You can see through that great big window, and that is a huge window with light. It's like right behind the little altar area that they have. There's a cross right there, and you cannot take that picture without that cross being superimposed over any spot of that Temple Mount. It shows the heart of Christ for the city of Jerusalem. And at that spot, it says that he saw the city and he wept over it. Now that word wept here in the Greek is the very strongest word that the Greek language has to signify what was going on. It is a sobbing. It is a heart-wrenching agony. The word klio means to weep aloud, expressing uncontainably, to audibly express grief by inarticulate or semi-articulate sounds, to groan. It's like when someone is told their loved one has tragically died, and the grief just completely overwhelms them. I do believe that it's the only time in Scripture that it's recorded that Jesus did that. Even in the Garden of Gethsemane, as he wept, it was like drops of blood. And I'm sure this had to play into it, of course, most definitely. But this is an uncontrollable weeping, a distinct grief that he had at this very spot. They did not know, and they would not know, the peace that he was making possible for them as hope had entered into Jerusalem. They didn't recognize it. They wouldn't recognize it even while they were waving their palm branches, because it was hidden and it was too late. Now, why was it hidden? That's where my mind goes. Okay, why was God hiding it from them? That's really bad. God, why would you hide something from the very people that you wanted to save? Well, it really is a little deceptive. It implies a responsibility for mankind. A responsibility for our own faults that we have to take responsibility for. God holds us, like he held them, responsible for what we refuse to see when we have been given the truth, or we are unable to see because of the sin that blocks that from our view. When our life is lived with sin, when we refuse to see the truth of what God has distinctively made known to us in his word, that's the responsibility. That's why it's hidden from our eyes. We want to know more about what God's word has. Confess and repent of sin so that it becomes clear to us when we see it. It was hidden for them from their eyes because their nature had never been yielded to him, and they wouldn't see what he was doing. There were people that did see, but not the great amount that was there. John MacArthur again says, William Griffith Thomas. He says, let us sit at Christ's feet until we learn the secret of his tears, and beholding the sins and sorrows of city and countryside, weep over them too. Do we weep over those whose eyes are blinded from the truth of the gospel? Because their destruction is going to be just as horrific as what Jerusalem's destruction was right there at this spot. So Jesus now gives a preview of coming attractions. They would soon be, as he said right here, he gave it to them, or to us to show, they would soon be surrounded, all of Jerusalem, by Titus, the Roman dude there who laid siege to Jerusalem in 70 AD. And the Bible tells us here, in this spot, and then we see that they built embankments, and the historians tell us this, they built embankments around the city and essentially blockaded them and starved them and waited them out, and they took one part of the city at a time until they had the entire city. The temple was destroyed. Not one stone was left upon another. And if you go to Jerusalem today, you'll see that it is way down deep and everything's built on top. That's why they have to dig down. Why? It was that destroyed. Everything was just on top. The homes, the temples, everything of value was just crashed in and it became dirt. And over the years and destruction, they would build on top of that. He could see the great slaughter as he was standing there looking at that temple mount. I believe he could see physically with his heart's eyes, and as an omniscient God man, he could see all that would happen right there, because he showed them, he spoke that there. It was recorded for us to be able to see that it was true. And he wept for the judgment that would come to them because of their refusal for the hope that he was giving. You know, there's certainly a lot more to life than what we see in the world around us, isn't there? We who have trusted in Christ for salvation see the glorious hope of all that he gives to us. And it is inspiring. It's encouraging to us, even in the midst of a broken world. Before the dawn of creation, the Lord has purposed hope in this world. Before we were ever created, he knew that there would be hope for us. the gospel, the good news of Christ, the fact that he came, lived a sinless life, that he was crucified, that he was buried, that he rose again on the third day, that he appeared to hundreds of people to show that he was really alive and ascended to the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes ever for us. That truth of the gospel is strategic, as it is meant for those who have no hope to now have hope, real, true hope. That day, whether it was Sunday or Monday or right there in between, whatever, whenever, the fact that it happened is the most important part, but that day was a beautiful story of real hope. And we here today in 2023 have partaken of the hope when we trust in Christ Jesus. That very hope that he offered, that he wept over Jerusalem because they refused. We can partake of that today right here. But there's always a darker side, isn't there? There's always an underside to every upside. For those who refuse the hope that Christ was offering then to them and us now, there is no hope. There is no hope. Real hope comes to us when we look forward towards the Lord and the hope that he offers. He's planned it that way. He scheduled that on that calendar at that time so that we would be able to see sitting here today that there is a hope and his name is Christ Jesus. And he weeps when we do not receive that hope. God is holding out hope through Jesus, through the story, and through the church of the living God as we are the hands, feet, and voice of Jesus right now to the world because he is the hope of the ages. So I ask you this today. Where is your hope placed? Is it on the upside or is it on the underside? Because if it's on the underside, it ain't real hope at all. Matter of fact, it's faux hope. It's not real. There's no hope. You really are kind of going, well, I hope it's going to be all right. That's a different kind of hope, folks. The beautiful story of our Savior's hope, he's made available. He made that day. He started it. He had already begun when he was born in Bethlehem and lived his life. But that day, he was saying to the world, I am he. I'm the King of Kings. I'm the Lord of Lords. I'm offering, I'm setting into place the hope that will lead to peace with God for all of man. So I ask you, is the Lord Jesus weeping over you today? Have you ever trusted him and committed to him? Have you ever said more than the crowd who says, he's got to be the king. He's the one I'm going to follow. But have you given your life to him and your all in a sacrifice of praise saying, I will serve you no matter what? There were those that day who did. Most of them paid with their life, and it was a difficult time for them. When God holds out that hope, your refusal to acknowledge him is no different than those Jews of that day who eventually said, crucify him. It wasn't saving faith. It was simply a baseless hope. So I encourage you, come to Jesus before the destruction comes. Because the rest of the scripture tells us, just as Jesus prophesied that in 70 AD, he tells us, behold, I am coming soon. And he tells what will happen in the earth. He tells what will happen to those who do not choose to follow him and do not make him Savior. The Apostle Paul puts it very distinctively as I close. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 and 2 says this, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God, through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Amen. Today, as we come to the Lord, where is he leading you? What do you need to do because of this? Maybe you say, I needed to hear that. I need to remember that. Maybe you're someone who says, I've never truly given that. I've never been one who, I outwardly, like the people there waving the branches and laying the clothes, I've done that, but I've never given my heart to him and let him forgive me. If that's you, don't leave this building without making that right. I'd love to speak with you. I'd like to talk with you. Father, thank you for how you are moving us today to just simply remember. The way we partake of communion, we say, this do in remembrance of me. Lord, may we remember you in all your ways. The entry into Jerusalem, how you faced the celebration, how heaven celebrated because something else was happening that those people knew nothing even about. And Lord, how you wept because they refused you and you knew in their hearts that they were refusing you. Lord, I ask that we would be pleasing unto you. Every man, woman, boy, and girl in this place, Lord, I pray that we would be those people who say, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom, like the thief on the cross. And that you would. Not only that we know who you are, but that you know us. In Jesus' name I pray.
Look down from a broken sky, traced out by the city lights, my world from a mile high.